Hello, LEGO fans. Welcome back to LEGO 48. Today I'm going to talk about how GBC modules are powered, especially at shows. First, a little history. That's me, 48 years ago, give or take, playing with my first LEGO train. A few years later, though, I got the 12-volt electric train, which I played with until I went to college. The point of this is, that train was powered by a transformer box that I like to call Big Blue. Well, now I call it the Binford GBC Master 6000. Anyway, this thing plugs directly into a 120-volt outlet and provides completely variable DC voltage from 0 up to 15 volts, allowing you to run the train anywhere from standing still to max speed. When I decided to start building GBCs, I saw videos where everything was controlled by this 9-volt speed controller. Naturally, I assumed that this was a more modern version of Big Blue, plugging into an electrical outlet and providing variable output voltage between 0 and 9 volts. And I further assumed that the reason for using these was so that the speed of each GBC module could be adjusted to get all of the modules to run at 60 volts per minute, according to the GBC standard. I mean, that's logical, right? Yeah, I was wrong on pretty much everything. Let's start with the speed controller. I bought one, only to discover that it's very thin underneath. It doesn't have near the bulk or weight of Big Blue. It also doesn't have a cord to plug it into an outlet. What? Apparently, this is just a controller. It actually needs a separate 9-volt DC transformer, something like this, to provide 9 volts of DC power to the controller. This has to be plugged into an electrical outlet, and then the other end plugs into this jack here. And now it can power a motor. The next surprise was that it's not as variable speed as Big Blue. Instead of providing a continuous range of voltages, the voltage is stepped. As you turn the dial, you have a choice of 6 different speeds. But that's it. Still, it's more flexibility than only having 2 speeds, on or off. So this should still allow some adjustment of GBC module speeds, right? Well, yeah, you can adjust the speed of a module with this controller, but that's not really what happens in practice. I found out at my first show that the convention is to set every controller up so that turning the dial to the right is the correct direction. And then all controllers are either turned straight up, off, or all the way to the right, on. Basically, these controllers are used as giant on-off switches. Unfortunately, these controllers are no longer produced by LEGO, so the only way to get them is to find them on the resale market. That's either BrickLink or BrickOwl. But they're already expensive and only getting more so as more people get into the GBC world. They're also kind of bulky if you have to take multiple controllers to a show in order to run more than one GBC module. So, is there a better way? I think there is. Before I went to Brickworld Chicago, I was told that it was a LEGO convention, and all parts in my mock had to be genuine LEGO, except for the electrics. When I got to the show, I was told by the GBC coordinator that the point was to show that GBCs could be done with exclusively LEGO parts. Well, that's all well and good, except that GBCs rely on a number of critical components that are no longer produced by LEGO, like the PF motors, the cables that connect them, and the speed controllers. This wasn't an issue in the early days of GBCs, but it's going to become a bigger issue as more people join this hobby. It's already a problem for the GBC workshops that have been a tradition at these shows, as genuine LEGO motors are getting harder to find in significant quantities. So, if all we need is on or off, can we build our own switch? This is what we're going to build. It's a switch box with 2 switches on it. A toggle switch for directional control, and a push button to turn the motor on and off. Yes, I could get away with just the toggle switch, and turn the motor off by moving the lever to the center position. This is how the Power Functions battery box works. Here's the problem with that. Many of my modules only work in one direction, and I can't ever remember which switch position I need to drive the module correctly. Enter the on-off button. Now I hook up the motor, set the toggle switch to the correct direction, and from then on, I turn things on or off with the push button. Very easy. here are the parts that we're going to need. We'll need a package of double-pole, double-throw toggle switches, a package of single-pole, single-throw push buttons, a package of 5.5 by 2.1 millimeter jacks for connecting our power supplies, and a spool of ribbon cable. We'll also need some power functions connectors. I just buy the short 20 centimeter extension cables and cut them in half, allowing me to make two control boxes out of each cable. We're also going to need two 4x4 modified plates, and one 1x2x2 panel for each controller. I try to find the cheapest ones that I can, because we're going to drill holes in them. I use a drill press and clamp the parts down before I drill, and I try to use a relatively low speed so the drill bit doesn't heat up and melt the plastic. The two plates get drilled with a hole in the center, sized to fit the two switches. The panel gets drilled in the middle for the jack. Now for the wiring. Here's the wiring diagram. Note that the PF connector has four pins in it. The two outer pins are always 9 volts and ground, respectively. These two wires aren't actually used by motors, but they will be used by any lighting system that runs off of PF connectors. The middle two wires also carry 9 volt and ground, but these are reversible based on the position of the toggle switch. This means that we're going to bring the 9 volt positive from the input jack to the on-off switch, and from there, we'll go to both the center pin on the toggle switch and directly to the number one wire. The negative wire will go to the other center pin on the toggle switch and directly to the number four wire. The number two wire will connect to one of the outside pins on the toggle switch with a short jumper wire to the opposite outside pin. Number three wire does the same, connecting to the other outside pin on this side, with another jumper crossing over to the opposite pin here. I'll implement this using 4-strand ribbon cable. After splitting the cable and stripping the ends of the wires, I connect some short jumpers to the ends, and then I can solder these to the switch contacts. The jumpers in the corners get shortened and are then soldered to the contacts in the opposite corners. The jumpers in the middle will get connected to one of the on-off button contacts and the negative wire from the jack, respectively. And then the positive wire from the jack is soldered to the other button contact. Finally, the four wires from the half of a connector cable are soldered to the other end of the ribbon cable and wrapped in electrical tape. Now that everything is wired, I can assemble the battery box. The panel with the jack goes at one end of the base plate. At the other end, I need to leave a slot for the ribbon cable. Then I build it up with bricks to a height of 3 rows, and finish with 2 plates with the switches in it. I still have a 2-stud by 4-stud area to cover, and I usually do that with a colored tile. I use a different color for each box, and put a matching tile on the motor or GBC module that it's connected to. At a show, when I have 3 or 4 boxes sitting next to each other, the colors help me quickly identify which box is controlling each item. Before I finish, I want to talk about the power supplies themselves. Most 9-volt DC power supplies have positive voltage in the center, with the ground on the outside. And the jacks that we're using assume the same. So the red wire comes from the tip, and the black wire leads to the ring. However, my favorite 9-volt DC power supplies actually come from music stores like the Guitar Center. They're used to power keyboards and amplifiers, and since they're used for music, they have to provide really clean and consistent DC current. My absolute favorite is this one-spot power supply, which is narrow enough to take up only one spot on a power strip, so you can put several of them side by side. It provides up to 1700 milliamps of current, which will allow me to run as many as 4 motors off of a single supply if I need to. The only issue with music industry power supplies is that their convention for voltage is to have the tip negative and positive voltage on the outside ring. That's not an issue if you're only going to control a motor, because motors only use the inner two wires, which are reversible anyway. However, if you want to be able to control lights, you will need to correct the polarity by reversing the wire connections coming from the jack. My original power boxes were all done with red bricks, expecting a tip-positive power supply. My newer boxes, specifically designed for the one-spot supplies, are done with black bricks, so I know that these are expecting a tip-negative power supply. I hope you found this helpful. Happy GBCing!